these. So we're going to get into the history of the Angel Oak. We're going to talk a little bit about, you know, just kind of what it means for Charleston today. Tell you a little bit about if you want to come and visit it when you're here in Charleston, tell you a little bit about that. And we're going to do a giveaway. We have a giveaway and a very cool one. I think that's pretty neat. So we will do that today as well. So with that, everybody, let's go ahead and get into today's topic. And of course, like I said, we're out here at Charleston's beautiful Angel Oak tree. And the Angel Oak, you hear a lot of different things about the tree itself. A lot of times people will hear, you'll take a tour and people will say it's the oldest living oak tree or the oldest living thing east of the Mississippi River. Sometimes you'll hear all sorts of different numbers in terms of how old the tree is. You'll hear definitely like 1400, 1500 years old and things like that. So let's talk a little bit about all that. So of course, let's go ahead and show you the star itself. Let's show you the tree. All right. So we turned the camera around. All right. So ladies and gentlemen, here you go. This is the beautiful Angel Oak tree. And so when you look at a lot of the dimensions of the tree itself, back in 1981, for example, the circumference of the tree itself was right about 25 and a half feet. But of course, it has been 30 years since that was taken. So now it is actually a little bit higher than that. From 25, it's now about 30 feet in circumference. It is about 66 feet tall, 17,000, a little over 17,000 square footage of shade that it provides for the area. And the longest tree limb is 187 feet long. And I think that the circumference of the longest tree limb is like 11 feet. So just absolutely remarkable. And so what about the age of the tree? Now, again, like I said, you'll hear a lot of people say that it's probably about 1500 years old, but that is actually not true. Of course, do we know the exact age of the tree? Nowhere near, but we estimate that it's probably actually closer to about 400 to 500 years old. So take off a century. Now, don't get me wrong, or a century, that's a millennia. But nevertheless, it is still a remarkably beautiful and a remarkably old tree, nevertheless. In fact, like I said, when you kind of hear a lot of those dates, and like I said, oldest thing east of the Mississippi River, unfortunately, that's also not correct. There's a lot of beautiful bald cypress trees that you will find in the East Coast that are much older than the Angel Oak, not only in South Carolina, but North Carolina, Georgia as well. So there's definitely some older things that are out there even today, but it still stands and makes its mark here in the low country. And that's what I do want to kind of talk about for today. So where we are, as you can kind of see, it's kind of a park. So let me just kind of pan around for a second. So you come down just off of Bowhicket Road in on John's Island. And like I said, John's Island, for anyone who doesn't know, is one of our sea islands or barrier islands in the low country. And it's about, we're probably about 20 minutes from downtown Charleston, so not too far at all. And there's a big fence that goes around and helps protect this place. So you just kind of park, and it's all completely free, by the way. So completely free to come out here. And so not only that, it kind of extends around. And as you can see, there's beautiful picnic tables and things that you can come out here and enjoy. You can bring food and picnics and whatnot. You can actually bring animals. You can bring your pets. But they're kind of, they are not allowed over by the tree. That's the only thing about the pets. They can't go to the tree. They're kind of have to stay over in this kind of distance. And then there's a nice shop, gift shop and everything kind of included. And there's ladies selling the sweetgrass baskets, locally made Charleston products in there. And a lot of things, of course, relating to the Angel Oak in and of itself. And so that's where we are, like I said, and this beautiful piece of property. But the land itself, and where the Angel Oak and kind of its history, of course, you know, like I said, 400 to 500 years old. So the first people, of course, that were going to be in this area were actually, of course, the Native Americans. And it is believed that even Native Americans would have been buried kind of around the tree. And so it's really hard to kind of prove that. But essentially where it comes into kind of the Charleston history, once Charleston got its start, was that in 1717, what would that be, about 50 years after Charleston, Charleston was founded. It actually was part of a land grant of about 96 acres that was actually deeded to a man by the name of Abraham Waite. Now, Abraham Waite actually arrived into Charleston as an indentured servant, because let's not forget that really the kind of first, and we kind of use the word quote here in terms of slavery, was actually through indentured servitude. So, you know, in order to actually progress and, of course, to have any kind of labor in the New World, they were using this notion of indentured servitude. You know, Charleston, like we've talked about numerous times before in our videos, was a land, and it was all founded for economic opportunity. This was a plan designed to make money for people back in England. So therefore, in order to get people to come over here, to actually come and settle, it was kind of a struggle. In fact, a lot of people couldn't even afford it. You know, it wasn't like today where you just buy a plane ticket, right, and very easily can cross the Atlantic. So for many, it was very, very difficult and very challenging to actually come here. So indentured servitude was a way to do that. And essentially, and what they did is that for anyone who wanted to come to the New World, they would sign a contract of servitude where they were indentured to another person. And they would contract out for a period of anywhere between 5 to 7 years on average. And it all kind of depended on the contract. And then they basically dedicated their life and basically slavery to that other individual. And so during that time, though, they're going to learn a trade, usually the trade of whoever they were indentured to. And then once, of course, they learn that trade and their indentured contract ran out, they then could actually go and purchase land and start a career, and they would have the knowledge of whatever business that may have been. So that was a way to get people to come to the New World, and Abraham Waite was one of them. And the person that he was indentured to was none other than his brother. So his brother Jacob was the one that he was indentured to. And so therefore, after he finished out his contract, he got married and he started to accumulate a number of different pieces of property and land grants around the area. Now, what's also interesting is that Jacob, his brother, would have benefited this from two ways. Number one, of course, he got labor, right? So he got this individual. He's going to, of course, pay for him to cross over. He's gotten this person who's now indentured to him, his own brother. But another thing that they were also encouraging for the people that were here to pay for people to, for others to join, they use what was called the headright system. And the headright system was basically the promise of, if you pay for these individuals to come over, then we will actually gift you with land. And so a lot of land was granted out through that headright system, and not just here in Carolina, but across the eastern seaboard of many of the early colonies. So with that, he ended up, of course, getting this small piece of property. And the first thing that he was growing out here was rice, and he would use the old tidal creeks, river tidal creeks and the tidal rivers, because, of course, as we've discussed before, the one thing that you definitely need for successful rice fields is water. And so it always had to go by the water itself. And so that's how he kind of got his start with that property. Now, one thing to consider is that a lot of times when people imagine the plantation system in the South, they imagine just these, you know, enormous plantations that went on for miles and thousands upon thousands of acres. But when it came to rice plantations, they actually worked on a much smaller scale. So typically a rice plantation would have only been about 500 acres. Not saying that's not large, but of course, it's just not what a lot of people kind of imagine. So 500 acres, and that's why a lot of plantation owners would own multiple plantations. If y'all remember when we went to Middleton Place a couple weeks ago, Arthur Middleton, and in fact the Middleton family, they own 19 plantations across the Lowcountry. So that was not uncommon by that planter aristocracy. So Abraham Waite would have been one owning multiples. Now, Abraham Waite was a Quaker, and one of the things that gets often associated with Quakerism is that it was one of the Christian denominations that did not believe in enslaved labor, using basically, of course, West Africans and so forth. And so while there was Quakers that were absolutely abolitionists, there's, you know, this kind of line between practicality and belief, because for people like Abraham Waite and, of course, his descendants, enslaved labor was really needed for the plantation system. So even if their faith kind of contradicted that, nevertheless, they were going to be owners of the enslaved individuals, and so that are going to work these fields. And so as you can imagine, with the enslaved labor that was here, kind of legends and things and kind of informed, and we, I don't know, can quite prove it, but that a lot of the enslaved would have actually been buried kind of around the tree. In fact, perhaps even some of them were hanged from the tree limbs themselves. And so now, do we have any specific documented stories historically? Not as much as we have just, you know, oral tradition. We just have the stories that have been passed down from generation to generation versus any kind of hard evidence. But eventually it got passed down through Abraham's descendants, and eventually it went to a young lady by the name of Martha, one of Abraham's descendants, her name was Martha Waite. And Martha Waite Tucker eventually got married, and the man that she married, his name was Justice Angel. And that is where the angel name comes from. And so Justice Angel and his wife, Martha Waite, are actually going to live on this plantation, where, of course, this tree would have been, of course, a major focal point. And they were the ones who really did enjoy this place through that kind of antebellum period in the Civil War, you know, before the Civil War, 1820s, 30s, and 40s, you know, leading up again to the outbreak of the Civil War in 1861. And so, like I said, they definitely would have enjoyed it. And by that point, there was roughly, if you kind of break down the numbers, there was probably about 40 slaves for every one white inhabitant of the time period right here on John's Island. But the one major difference that kind of happened through the transitions of the families that lived here was that they shifted away from kind of rice production. They were still growing rice in certain areas on the Sea Islands, but a different crop kind of came up as even like almost to the point of, I want to say, more popular, but especially on the Sea Islands, it grew more successfully. That's a better way of putting it. And that would have been Sea Island cotton. And so, you know, I often hear in these phrase, cotton was king all throughout the South. Well, absolutely, you know, without a doubt being true. And so cotton was grown in the Low Country, but we grew a very, very specific kind of cotton that was called Sea Island cotton that was grown here in the Low Country. And it succeeded very well on the Barrier Islands. So James Island, John's Island, all of these eventually kind of grew away from rice and became even came even more to cotton production. And so rice was much more popular further inland once you got closer to the fresh water up and down the Ashley and the Cooper Rivers. So nevertheless, cotton would have been one of the major things coming out of this plantation owned by Justice Angel and, like I said, his wife Martha. So what happened? So after the Civil War, of course, basically many of the white inhabitants are all going to flee John's Island, where we are. They actually wanted to get the heck out of Dodge as quickly as possible because much of John's Island burned during the Civil War. It was very close to the Union. Of course, the Union was when they were launching the blockade, of course, and the bombardment onto the city. So essentially after the Civil War, people came back to a very different place. In fact, you can kind of look at it as a kind of dichotomy, as life before the war and life after the war were kind of very two ends of the spectrum. And so it was actually Justice Angel's, you know, descendants were the ones that came back. And what happened, of course, rice, well, you know, no one could work the fields anymore. Slave labor was outlawed. So rice is going to kind of quickly kind of diminish. Cotton eventually was destroyed by the boll weevil insect. And so essentially, of course, the plantation system just collapsed across the South. And of course, John's Island would have been no different. And so the tree, of course, has just been remarkably kind of saved and preserved throughout all of these years and has kind of stayed a testament to the time of its history, you know, and all of that, the tree remains. Now, don't get me wrong, you know, Charleston has seen, of course, a lot of storms and hurricanes. And during that 1989 Hurricane Hugo, of course, is going to deal with some damage to the tree, but it was able to recover from that. And in 1991, the city of Charleston itself actually purchased the area. And today, of course, it is protected. In fact, back in 2013, there was actually a notion that kind of on the cusp of the Angel, they wanted to do some development. I believe it was over here that they actually wanted to do and put up some like condos or something over in this area. But of course, there was a lot of backlash for that because they didn't want to, of course, ruin anything that chance of the survival of the beautiful Angel Oak tree. So thankfully, a kind of trust was formed, and they actually were able to get about 70 of the acres around the area kind of preserved, so that way no more kind of development would take place, and making sure that the tree would stay preserved kind of going forward. And so it is, like I said, a testament. There's about 500,000 people that will come and visit. As you can see right now, people are out here enjoying the beautiful weather, which, by the way, today is about one of the most remarkably beautiful days that we've had. It is like 70 degrees. So anyone who is watching that is local, if you've not been outside today, go outside. It is a gorgeous, gorgeous day. And so with that, I will tell you, things are very different though, from even when I was growing up here to, you know, generation before, because, you know, back in the 60s and 70s, it was a place that you could come out during the day. You could come out and, you know, like I said, picnic and kind of enjoy it, but you could also come out at night. They didn't actually have that fence up that you see. So people would come out and they would kind of, you know, and just enjoy kind of the moonlight and things, but eventually got kind of actually dangerous. In the 1970s, there was a lot of shady things that were going down. You would have seen drug deals, you know, things like that happening around around the area. And so for that reason, that was when you start to see, of course, the protection and the fence and things go up, of course, so that it can be preserved as much as possible. And that's another reason why they put up the shop, so that there's always people here just making sure that, you know, the tree is, you know, being saved and being not, you know, abused or hurt, or people making carvings in it or things along those lines. In fact, as a kid, I even remember coming out here and we used to be able to play as children on the limbs of the Angel Oak, but unfortunately you cannot do that anymore. That is all off limits. So you can come and you can just enjoy, of course, the kind of natural beauty to it. So with that, let me see here. We got, I want to turn the camera back around because I did want to share, I want to kind of look at some of the comments and what y'all think about the Angel Oak. And of course, I definitely want to answer any questions that y'all might have. But one of the things that I wanted to share with y'all is actually a really neat ghost story that pertains to the Angel Oak, especially from before the fence came up, and pertaining essentially to when people would especially come out here at nighttime. And so even if you were to come down here at night, clearly you cannot come and cross the fence, but you can at least kind of drive down the road. And a lot of times people will say that as they go down the, as they visited the Angel Oak at night, is that they can actually see glowing figures kind of all around the tree, even up in the limbs and whatnot. And so back years ago, there was a couple that is said to have gotten married underneath the Angel Oak. And a couple years later, they decided that they wanted to revisit that place at nighttime. And so they visited the Angel Oak. And while they were here, the woman said that she just felt this kind of presence around her, like that they were not alone by any measure while they were standing around the beautiful Angel Oak. And so the young man during that time, he decided that he was going to carve a heart into the oak, or into the oak of the tree, and kind of maybe leave their initials, now knowing full well, of course, that that's where they got married. Well, as he went to reach for his knife, they said there was this kind of blinding flash that was towards them. And as they looked, they just saw this face. And the face kind of had this kind of half animal, half kind of demonic look to it. And it was enough to kind of scare them out of their skin. And so she looked at, the young lady looked at her husband and said, put that knife away. And so that's exactly what they did. And no mark was left on the tree. So it is actually believed that the spirits of not only the Native Americans, but of the enslaved people that were all once part of this property are now serving as the angels, the guardians of this beautiful place. And so whenever someone were to come to do the place harm, is that they are fully there to protect this tree for generations to come.